Gospel according to St. Matthew, and I invite you to stand as you find the scripture today, Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 through 9. Today is Transfiguration Sunday, and we're going to hear the story of the Transfiguration today. Matthew chapter 17, beginning with verse 1. Let's hear the gospel of the Lord. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up. Do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to Christ. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word to us today. May your Spirit so enlighten it, and so open our ears, and so melt our hearts, that we might be changed by it today. May you grant your anointing in this time of preaching, we ask. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. What a privilege to get chosen not just to be a part of the 12 disciples, but to be one of the three in Jesus' inner circle. Peter, James, and John alone, out of all 12, were invited to go with Jesus up the mountainside. I wonder what they might have been expecting, what they might have been anticipating. Was Jesus going to talk with them about his plans to ascend David's throne and then to deliver the Jewish people from Rome? Was Jesus going to talk with them about what important role the three of them were going to have in his kingdom? Or was he just simply going to kick back and take a bit of a retreat with them? I don't know what they may have been thinking was going to happen. I doubt very much, though, that they had any idea what was actually about to take place. Our culture is very familiar with people that transform. At least people like me and my son and a few others know all kinds of people and things that transform in amazing, sudden ways. There's a whole group of cars and other vehicles that can transform into robots. They're called Transformers. See, some of you know about that. I saw on Facebook a video of an actual car that was able to transform. And I couldn't walk and talk and everything like the robot, but it stood up and everything. It's kind of interesting. And then you have a man named Bruce Banner, who you would not like when he's angry. Because when he's angry, he transforms into the Incredible Hulk. There's a woman named Diana Prince who, at least in the 70s, used to spin. And when she would do this spin, there'd be this great flash of light, and she would transform into Wonder Woman. There's Bruce Wayne and Dick Grayson at the other church. I said Dick Clark, wrong guy. Dick Grayson. Going down the bat poles, they would transform into Batman and Robin. And then there's Clark Kent, who would go into a phone booth. And some of you probably wonder what a phone booth is. They'd go into a phone booth as a mild-mannered reporter, but when he came out, he would be Superman. See, we're familiar with all kinds of people who can transform, at least in comic books and on TV and in the movies. But I have to tell you, not even Wonder Woman with that big flash of light could compare to what the three disciples saw in reality that day on the mountaintop. We're told that Jesus was transfigured, that's the word, transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun. It reminds me of our Wednesday study, where we find that at the end of the book of the Revelation, that the new Jerusalem that comes down out of heaven to be with us is said to have no need of the sun or moon, for the glory of God is its light. Jesus' face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. We're also told that all of a sudden, the three disciples were no longer alone with Jesus, but there were two other people that met them there. Now, you might think that that would make them feel a little less special. It was no longer just Jesus and them, but now these other two are kind of pushing their way in. But that's not how they took it. After all, the other two, none other than Moses and Elijah, who represented the entire law and the prophets of our Old Testament. I mean, this was amazing. We can read it, we can think about it, but we cannot truly imagine what it must have been like. And Peter responded, I think, like most of us would. Now, I don't know that we would all come up with the same, solution here, but the idea that is behind what he comes up with, I think, is an idea that most of us have. You see, Peter said, Lord, it's good for us to be here. Why don't I make three tents, three dwellings here? One for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah. Like I said, I don't know that we would come up with the whole tent idea, but what he's trying to say, the idea behind it is, hey, this is good. This is great. Man, we don't want to leave. We want to stay right here on this mountaintop with Moses and Elijah and with you, Jesus, with your glory just shining forth. Wouldn't you love to experience the glory of the Lord? That's exactly how St. Peter describes it in 2 Peter 1. It was majestic glory that they saw with their very own eyes. Perhaps some of you have been in services where God's glory, at least to a degree, was poured out. The Wesleyan tradition has been a tradition that has experienced the glory of the Lord. It's been seen in camp meetings across the nations. It's been seen in revival services. P.F. Brazee, the principal founder of our denomination, used to worship in what they called the glory barn. Early Wesleyan holiness evangelist Uncle Buddy Robinson, some of you will know that name. Uncle Buddy Robinson used to say that he used to exhort us to stay under the spout where the glory comes out. I've told you stories about whenever I've seen the glory of the Lord move in the midst of the service, where all I could do was just sit back and watch as people would stand and give testimonies, as tears flowed, as people would gather around the altar, as God's Spirit just swept over the congregation. And perhaps you've experienced that kind of a thing. Maybe it wasn't on par with the mountaintop experience that the three disciples had that day, but it was a mountaintop experience to be sure. We love those kinds of experiences, don't we? Those of you who have experienced them, we love those kinds of experiences. And like Peter, we want to capture it. We want to hold on to it. We want to live there in that experience of the glory of the Lord. In fact, there are so many people who so long for the glory of the Lord that they even manufacture it, or at least they try to. They try to make it happen. They try to whip up emotions. We're emotional people. Some people show their emotions more than others, but God created us with emotions. And it's fine to be touched with our emotions. But people sometimes try to take advantage of, they try to whip up people's emotions in order to, quote, capture the glory of the Lord. Maybe I've told this, I don't know if I've told this here or not, but I was visiting a district camp meeting one time on a different district, where that's exactly what I think some of the people in the congregation were trying to do. I don't think that they were trying to be deceitful. I don't think they had bad intentions, but I think that's what they were trying to do, because they would start shouting and hollering and waving their hands and kind of jumping around. And perhaps it was just me, but I didn't sense the Holy Spirit moving at all. Instead, it just seemed that they were doing what they were doing because It's what you do during camp meeting. It's what happens when the glory falls. And so if it's what happens when the glory falls, if we do it, maybe the glory will fall. Now, I've seen the real thing, but they're not so much. It sure seemed like they were trying to hammer some pegs, tent pegs, into the ground, you know, in order to capture the glory of the Lord. People long for experience, but sometimes in our longing for the experience, or for our longing in our longing to hold on to the experience, we miss what the experience is all about. Sometimes we miss what we are supposed to be getting out of the experience. And that is almost what happened to Peter, James, and John. Peter said, "Lord, if you wish, I'll make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." But while he was still yet speaking, suddenly we are told that the glory that had shone forth from Jesus enveloped them. A bright cloud overshadowed them. Does this sound familiar to us? You see, most people on Transfiguration Sunday point back to Moses' experience on the mountaintop when God gave the Ten Commandments. In fact, the Old Testament reading that is given for today is Exodus 24. There we read that a cloud covered the mountain and that the glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and we're told that the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire. Sounds a lot like this, doesn't it? When I read about the bright cloud overshadowing Peter and the other two, I'm also reminded of the dedication of the temple in the Old Testament. In 1 Kings and also in 2 Chronicles, we are told that as the temple is dedicated, the Shekinah glory is the word that's used, the Shekinah glory, the cloud of God's glory so filled the temple that the priests could not even stand to minister. That's the power of the cloud of God's glory. We want God's glory, but I'm not quite sure what we would do if God's glory was poured out like that. I take that back. Actually, I do know what we would do, because we see it both in the Old Testament and we see it in the New Testament on the Mount of Transfiguration. When the cloud overshadowed them, they heard the voice of God the Father come from the cloud saying, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I'm well pleased." And the disciples fell to the ground as though they're dead, trembling in fear. That's what we would do if God's glory fell upon us like that. Folks, the words of the Father are significant here. Peter is offered to build the three dwellings, for Moses, Elijah, and for Jesus. And the Father says, "This is my Son, the Beloved." And after this, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. St. Matthew is trying to make sure, just in case we might miss it, he's making sure that we don't miss it here. Listen to how he tells the story again. "This is my Son. They saw no one except Jesus himself alone." As vitally and important as Moses and Elijah are, and they are important, Moses was the great deliverer. He was the lawgiver. Elijah was the prince of the prophets. But as important as they are, neither of them are God's Son. They point ahead. The law and the prophets point ahead. The scriptures in the Old Testament point ahead to Jesus, who is the only begotten Son of the Father. He is God the Son. Even if Peter were going to err by trying to hold on to the glory of that experience, he shouldn't have suggested three tents, as if the other two were somehow on the same par with Jesus. Jesus himself alone is God the Son. But the other thing that the Father says is also of great importance. He says, "This is my Son, the Beloved. With him I'm well pleased. Listen to me." The NRSV translates it well with the emphatic exclamation mark at the end of that. Listen to him, exclamation mark. You see, so many times in the church, we long for the experience of God's glory, and that's understandable, but even more important for us is that we listen to him. So often people so want the experience, but they want it without really listening. They aren't all that interested in listening. Because you see, when we have the experience, it can thrill us. It can stir us. It can impact us. It makes us feel good. But folks, when we listen to him, that is, when we listen and obey, that changes us. So what is it that we hear when we listen to Jesus? We hear all kinds of things when we listen to him. We hear, repent and believe the good news, for the kingdom of God has come near. We hear, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. We hear things like the Sermon on the Mount that we've been talking about over the last couple of weeks. Blessed are the poor in spirit. And then all of those that are listed in the Beatitudes there. The places where he says, you've heard it said this, but I say to you this. Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. We hear Jesus talk about how we ought to be treating the least of these, his brothers. And when you do it unto them, the least of them, you're doing it unto me, he says. He talks about clothing the naked and feeding the hungry and all kinds of things. When we listen to Jesus, we are changed. But what about the context in which we find today's scripture? Was the Father pointing out something specific that the three disciples should have been hearing from Jesus? Our chapter begins, our text begins with these words, 6 days later. So what is it that happened 6 days earlier? Back in chapter 16, beginning with verse 21, we discover Jesus telling the disciples about how he's going to go to Jerusalem and how he's going to be arrested and he's going to be taken, he's going to be mocked, he's going to be flogged, he's going to be killed, and on the third day he's going to rise again. And then Peter says to him, he rebukes Jesus and he says to him, this cannot happen to you. And then Jesus responds, and anybody remember how Jesus responds? He says to Peter, you got it, brother. Get thee behind me, Satan. Because you put your mind not on divine things, but you put your mind on human things. And then Jesus goes on to say in verses 24 and 25, if anyone wants to become one of my followers, one of my disciples, they have to deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Because if you try to hold on to and save your life, you're going to lose it. But if you're willing to give up your life for my sake, then you will gain eternal life. You see, folks, it's great to have the mountaintop experiences. It really is. And it is fine to seek the glory of the Lord, to seek his presence. And indeed, we should. I don't mean try to manufacture it, but to seek the Spirit's genuine outpouring upon us. But folks, if we don't listen, if we aren't being obedient, if we just kind of gather together in a group to hear, you know, a lot of good music, kind of a concert kind of a thing that sort of entertains us, and we call it worship. You don't get that here because we can't quite do that, but if there's a lot of people who do, if you gather together and that's all you do, if we aren't allowing the Word of God to speak and to change us, we'll never really be disciples of Jesus. We can call ourselves Christians, but we will never truly be followers of Jesus. We will be like those who are seeking to save our own lives and will end up losing them. But if we're really willing to be those people who are listening, allowing his words to shape us, then we may very well be those who lose their lives for his sake, but we can be assured that in doing so, we will gain life abundant and life eternal. Now, folks, obviously, listening to him means that we need to be in his word. We need to be people of the word. We need to read the word. We need to listen to others who read the word and those who proclaim the word. We need to listen for the voice of the Holy Spirit who speaks to us through scripture and then speaks to us in our lives. And I'll go back. Since she's not here, I can get away with it one more time. Chris, don't tell her. Vicky's testimony, you remember some of you were here about her work and the kind of altercation that took place. And then at the desk, remembering God saying to her, you're supposed to be at peace with all people and all this. Let me tell you, folks, if we're people of the Word and we're listening for his Spirit, he will speak to us in our lives. I love the prayer that's in the Book of Common Prayer that says, I won't pray the whole prayer, but I'll read the first part of it. It says this, blessed Lord, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant us so to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them. Isn't that great? That is our prayer, man. That ought to be the prayer that we make. Grant us to hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them. Folks, if we pray, Word of God speak. And if we listen, God will be faithful to speak to us. And if we will recognize, as did St. Peter, that the Lord has the words of eternal life, sometimes they're difficult words, but they are the words of eternal life. And thus, if we are obedient to His word, we will discover that it is not just Jesus who will be transformed on that mountain, but we too will be transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit so that we might reflect His glory. Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.